Executive Department.
Sir, Mr. Chairman. First on the agenda tonight for scheduled appointments is regarding Meade's annual application for funding, also known as their anti-poverty plan. The next Edgecombe Economic Development Incorporated, or Meade Incorporated, receives federal funding through the Community Service Block Grant Program. The requirement of the program is to present their application for funding, which is their anti-poverty plan, to the Board of Commissioners in each county base. This plan discusses their strategies for eliminating poverty within their service area. A copy of the plan is included in your agenda pack. No action is needed of you. Meade Incorporated is required to distribute a copy of the plan to you prior to its submission. You're also to be given an opportunity to submit your comments along with the plan. Representatives from Meade are present tonight to answer any questions that you might have.
Good evening, everyone.
As Ms. Cole stated, I just wanted to give you guys a little update on some of the outcomes that we do have this year. So we wrote in our work plan to serve 100 clients for our fiscal year this year, and we're actually at 103. The number of low participant families rising from poverty, we had a goal of 20, right now we're at 12, which is amazing. The number of participant families obtaining employment is 30, right now we're at 26. Due to individuals going back to work to COVID, we were able to get a lot of clients employed this year. Versus last year, we had a struggle for that. For this year, we've seen a lot of turnaround in income and employment for our clients. The number of participant families who are employed and obtain better employment was 30. That was our goal, and right now we're at 17. The number of jobs with medical benefits obtained, our goal was 15, and we're at 8. And the number of participant families completing education training programs is 30. That number is our lowest number for our outcomes. We are at 10 right now. Main reason a lot of our clients are really trying to get back to work and get some income in their household. So we're keeping that in mind as we're having people come in that are expressing interest in education and employment as well. Any questions?
Any questions from the board?
That 2018 was the last one, the year?
Yes, ma'am. So this is our last year within this fiscal grant. So nothing has changed. So each grant period is for three year process. So this is our last year within that 3 year process.
So you don't have to say what the strategic plan, but every year. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, ma'am.
For OEO.
For OEO.
So we are now currently working with our community needs assessment. We have a consultant who is helping us. We have a survey link on our website. If anyone would like to go on our website and do a survey, and as soon as we get data from that and start the survey, then we'll start to be paying.
Any other questions or comments? Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Sir, the next scheduled appointment is the Twin Counties Opioid Settlement Committee. As you know, a settlement was reached on the nationwide opioid litigation. The National Association of Counties, along with the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners, crafted a settlement agreement for our state where funds will be provided directly to counties. These funds can be used for a number of opioid mediation activities. The Twin County Opioid Settlement Committee is a group of partners working to elevate the needs related to the opioid crisis and propose strategies to address this critical issue. And tonight we have Ms. Becky Copeland, who is here from the committee to present impact of the crisis on Edgecombe County and recommend the strategies. She also has some of her colleagues who are joining by Zoom who may chime in from time to time.
Ms. Copeland.
Thank you so much. I'd like to say good evening to the chair, to all of our board here at Edgecombe County, to our manager of community members. Thank you so much for allowing the opportunity to speak to you tonight around our opioid crisis and settlement funds. I'm here as the coordinator of our Twin Counties partnership, and back to county managers and colleagues on virtually to chime in if you need to. As I commit to you as a non-clinical person, but with the good fortune of being surrounded by very well-able, competent clinicians available for us if you have further questions.
And if I could point out, you'll see there's a presentation on the screen. There's my copy in your eager agenda.
Wilson showing a 31% increase in ED visits from over there. You'll see here, when we bring it back regionally compared to the state, Edgecombe County increased in 2019 from 163.2 per 100,000 residents for ED overdose rates. It increased in 2020 to 188.5 per 100,000 residents. With Nash and Wilson also, all three of us above the state rate for ED overdose. Yes, sir.
Go ahead, Bob.
You're saying 100,000, we don't have 100,000 people in Edgecombe County, so can you say those numbers are correct?
Our data was gathered from our team. It was pulled from some local and state level data, and I have them available to answer via that source. But they split out the ratios according to the one. There were 100,000 residents.
What
that
was
saying.
That's why I'm saying the numbers. It's all proportion. Okay. So this is emergency department business.
Yes.
How do we know? So everyone that goes to the emergency department in Tarboro will say, how many are so we know how many edge on the ground residents have actually.
That's not separated in this data per se. It's the data that's collected is to do with the ED visits to.
It just so happens that it's in our park, so we don't know the home residents of those people.
Not in this state.
Okay.
Again, in regional data here, our EMS reports over 50%. Of overdose patients who they are seen and are resuscitated by emergency workers, they refuse to be transported to the ED. And then we know that the people at highest risk for overdose deaths are those who have overdosed before. We want to share with you a list of existing efforts that are ongoing across Edgecombe County. You'll see we have people from rural health groups to local service providers for substance misuse. We have area LAPEC, Body Hospital. Just want you to be aware of a group of people that are already some boots on the ground and doing their part as best as possible with our current reality to try and confront this very serious crisis. Other efforts combined with that partner list is our CORE, reestablishment of CORE, doing a great job coming together, pulling partners together to try to brainstorm around what helps might be for our communities here in Edgecombe. Our Twin Counties Partnership also hosts regular meetings, and our effort is to try to share information, try to help people know as much as possible about existing efforts, and then it also puts everybody in a space to try to brainstorm around how we might fill existing gaps. So here are some of our efforts that are ongoing to the extent that we are able to do with the capacity that we also have. Northern Upper Coastal Plains Council of Government hired a full-time opioid navigator to try and help address the substance issues, and that their efforts trying to help businesses become aware of treatment resources. Other efforts trying to build systems to provide coordinated care for individuals at high risk of overdose, ensure referrals of treatment recovery resources from the EMS and providers, one to increase for medication-assisted therapies in primary care settings. Still, again, that is good news for us, the fact that we do have some efforts in place, and I guess it's a matter of trying to figure out how to tighten the screws and then increase capacity for what's already existing. discussion and trying to increase options such as counseling and serene services. These continue to serve clients in our communities. This I want to share with you is a story of a local resident here in the county. This is a 30-year-old male who had a 10-year experience with substance use. And after many hardships and trials, you can see that this person had two prison terms that were served. And he got, he was treated with the medication-assisted therapy. And then he has now been 2 years in recovery, thankfully. You'll see that his life has turned and turned, that things are back on track. That not only is he handling, managing his mental health disorders, but his medical issues are being resolved as well. And this person is back to full-time employment. Share this experience because it is a reminder for us that there is help and that success is possible. But I want to contrast that with the story of this person, another local person who shares how tough it is to receive treatment here in the county. This person states that there is really nowhere to run. It's just nowhere to go. It's like you're looking for help, and it's like all the doors. It feels like all the doors are closed, or the doors are too far away to be open. We really need something in this environment. The desperation of this person says that I want a sponsor in this area, because this place, I have one in another area, and I need someone close by that we could just get up with and go talk to anytime. I need someone close. The virtual groups are good, but it's not like hands-on. So I want you to know that success is possible, but the struggle is still real for those who are still in the middle of this challenge and want to think about that there are so many families here in our surroundings that are still in the thick of it, just as this community member was. Wanted to think about efforts moving forward here, like the opportunity to share data so that we could track progress. That would be something that would be very beneficial for as we move forward, because the data can help us know how we're progressing. Notions around psychiatric care for co-occurring behavioral health issues, outreach systems for people who overdose, who don't proceed to care. Think about when our EMS workers say that 50% after they're resuscitated will not come for further care. Just think about the opportunity for outreach programs that can go and help and bridge that gap for us. We're looking towards peer support activities and jobs through recovery case management, along with a list of other things that we think could help move the needle of success when we're talking about substance use and misuse. Want to remind you of collaboration being the key to preventing individuals from falling through the cracks, and that we believe that holistic care ensures client success. And what holistic care would look like for us is that we are able to have peer, family, and community support, that there is opportunity for employment and education, and that our community members could have access to case management to help tailor plans specific to their individual needs. Building sustainable and referral systems is very important, looking down the road for long-term peer support and employment opportunities. These are things that we believe can be game changers as we move forward trying to figure out how to address opioid crisis and other substance misuse in our counties. So my real purpose for standing here and trying to just give this bit of insight to you as a body, a governing body here in Edgecombe, to say that we have many service providers and community members. We consider each of them a part of a solution. We don't find one of us with a total package. And
what we would really like to ask you is to consider, as you're moving forward with the opioid settlement that has been allotted for your county, if you would just consider the voices of a broader community. Hopefully that would include the service providers. We've kind of assembled in our collaboration a group of, a prepared group of experts around substance use and misuse. And then there are people who are in direct contact with community members who've lived this experience, and they can give great insight as to what a real action plan could look like in addressing this crisis. So again, just to thank you again for allowing us your ear to ask if you would just consider just the opportunity to listen to broader voices as you make your strategic plan towards this recovery effort. Any other questions for me? Like I said, we do have clinical people available if you have additional questions. Thank you so much.
More I see where, if I'm not mistaken, that North Carolina will get $2.68 million.
No, sir, I'm sorry, that is your Edgecombe County.
Edgecombe County.
The 2.86 million is the Edgecombe County of Boston.
But it's gonna be spread over 16-year period.
Yes, sir, with the front load coming within the first 2 or 3 years, in the first 2 years or 3 years, it is front loaded with a heavier portion in the first 3 years, I think it is, and then the allotments continue across the rest of it. And that's why it was so important to us to know that since we have the luxury of a 16-18 year period for grants to be spread across, like knowing that those funds will be in place, how do we get the most impact in a way that 18 years down the road, Edgecombe County looks very different with regard to substance misuse and abuse? How do we turn the tide? How do we anchor this with other efforts that are going on that creates just better solutions overall in our county with regard to substance misuse? Yeah, so the 2.5686, that's the Edgecombe County portion, because it's distributed according to what your opioid numbers were in the particular county.
Yeah, what? If not, I think the board welcomes any recommendation from the committee as to how we might do so far. The board welcomes recommendation from your committee as how we might use those funds.
Thank you. We've been very fortunate in communications with County Manager Evans here. He's been very open, and I know that Edgecombe County, just the fact of how he was so open, knowing what this means to your county and the importance where it fits on your agenda also. He's just been so open to us and the meetings here again with the reinstitution of CORE, which is your Edgecombe County Coalition. Those partners right there are already collaborating, and what things that we can do as a, like a Twin County partnership, we just like distributing information and how do we work with the intention of bringing people together. So the partnership sets in a neutral space to try and improve whatever efforts and support efforts across the county. So if there are additional things that we can get by way of data, then we'll have them pull that together, because that was what we were wanting, is to have a group of experts already prepared for you. And I've come from rural counties, and I know that most of the time that doesn't happen. And the tendency is that when money drops, you pass it over to the quick place to get rid of it. I mean, it's through a channel that's in place, and it's easy to pass over, but to make it impactful in situations like this because of the complexity of the issue, broader voices can help to give us a better action plan.
Any other questions?
Mr. Chairman, if I could add, and so I'm very appreciative of our working relationship with the Twin Counties Partnership. And so, as she said, you know, we have an allotment that's set as earmarked for Edgecombe County. Our annual allocation will range somewhere between $150,000 to $200,000 a year over the 18-year period. And so, as she mentioned, CORE, which was, you know, started a few years ago by the Sheriff's Office and the Health Department with other partners, EMS and other partners at the table, we have revived that. So that's going to be your group here that will make final recommendations to this board. And having a partner like the Twin Counties Coalition, they bring a broad range of opinions and voices. We have representation that attends their meetings, and so we appreciate that working relationship. But as we get closer to when we expect to actually start receiving those funds, we've already, our group, or we've already been meeting to talk about recommended strategies, and it includes some of which have been recommended by this group. But as we approach, get closer to our expected receipt of the first allocation of those funds, we'll be bringing back a recommendation to this group.
Does it cost us anything to pay this group here?
No.
They get all 2.6 million? To choose as we see fit based on recommendations?
No, sir.
No, no.
You're saying it's a cost us?
Yes, yeah, all we have is extending money out for administration of that grant.
No.
It comes from all of us and we decide to make the final decision.
That's correct. That's correct. And what we'll likely expect to happen is that we'll likely bring back a recommendation to you to distribute that over a few different strategies. So there might be some that will go to a particular provider. There might be some that we decide that we want to use some of it to have a navigator in-house specifically for Edgecombe County. So it'll be some that we might see used in-house, that there might be some, likely be some, that we'll recommend that we distribute to some outside organization to administer some strategy that we all agree that is important.
It'd be nice if we could take a lump sum over a period of time and let us just use the earnings off of it in perpetuity. Probably what happened, turn around at 2.6 million.
Well, 18 years or go by quickly, and as Ms. Copeland said, that's why it's important for us to be as strategic as we possibly can. I don't plan to be working here 18 years from now, but whoever is, hopefully we can look back and see that that money was strategically invested and the needle was moved in this particular process.
But you made a comment that we're going to get this front loaded, so we're going to get a majority of the money in the first 10 years.
Right. If the annual appropriation will be more on the front end, and then it'll trail off on the latter.
Any other questions or comments? Thank you, Ryan.
Thank you.
Next introduction of Mr. Webb.
Yes, sir. It is indeed my honor to introduce you tonight, a young man by the name of Connor Pippen. Connor is seated next to his dad, Craig Pippen. In regards to that honor, I had a wonderful opportunity of instructing Connor's mom for a couple years over at Edgecombe Community College, who became a graduate respiratory therapist, did a great job in the field. In fact, a family nurse practitioner school that's come into Oregon is now an instructor over at National Community College. Connor, if you'll allow me to tell a little bit about your dad before we get to you. Craig is also a paramedic serving over in Halifax County, and he's also worked here in Edgecombe County. Thank you so much for the services of his mom and his dad. Now, Connor. The reason Connor is here tonight is, let me say first of all, Connor had choices like many of us do. Connor is from Troop 587 over in the representing the West Edgecombe Rural Club. Connor is working on his citizenship in communities merit badge. And I believe I'm correct in saying that after he gets this merit badge, Connor, you might go for your citizenship in the state, citizenship in the nation, and citizenship in school. All I can say is thanks be to Skyler. Connor, to make you feel a little bit more at home tonight, let me say this to you. This is our Commissioner Billy Wooten. Mr. Wooten's son, Will, just recently achieved the level of an Eagle Scout. He was here in a meeting of ours a while back, and let me just tell you, Will has done some wonderful, wonderful things and raised thousands and thousands of dollars for a local fire department here in Edgecombe County. So you see where I'm going, we're looking at you to do that. The other thing I want to say to you, Connor, is also our Chairman Wiggins. Chairman Wiggins' son, once upon a time, was a little boy, a little young youth like you, who is now our Edgecombe County judge, Lamont Wiggins. So what a wonderful job scouting does for our youth. Connor, we just want to say to you, we know where you live, we know where you reside, and it's just about this far from the Edgecombe County line, and you're there in Nash County. So you had a choice to go to Nash County to their commissioner's meeting. You had a chance to go to a school board meeting. All I want to say is, Connor, welcome, congratulations, and we're so glad to have you I don't have to ask, but before he leaves here, fellow commissioners, would you please stop by and say hello to Connor? Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Would y'all like to meet him?
Just thank y'all for allowing us to be here and learn.
Thank you so much for coming. That's it.
Yes, sir. Tonight I'd like to have Ms. Michelle Heffler come to the podium. It is my pleasure tonight to no longer have to introduce her as our interim health director. She is now, in fact, Edgecombe County Director of our Health Department. Very pleased she's been doing a fantastic job as the interim. Recently made that appointment, and she had it and she accepted, so congratulations.
Thank you.
You're right.
Thank you. Age kids, 19%, 12%, 10%. So we are on the low end.
So when we got that shipment, we had to decide, you know, what are, how are we going to get, you know, just a little bit of masks to as many people as possible. So we had decided to start with one mask per person per week is what we started to distribute. We are also asked to be able to distribute them to the jail, to homeless shelters, to community centers, senior citizens, anywhere else that was in need of churches. So we are supposed to spread out 4,700 masks somehow. So we did, fortunately, were able to request more masks. We did. As soon as we could, we asked for 5,000 more masks. Received them pretty quick and started to distribute 3 masks per person. So that's where we are at now. In both locations, here in Tarboro and in Rocky Mount, we do have masks available for the community to come in and get. That is my report.
Any questions?
Okay.
First, let's talk about this homestead that nobody knows who got it. So what if, hypothetically, a person has problems? We're gonna go on good, they're gonna go on good faith. I mean, how do you know that they're not spreading it? I get it. How do you know I'm not, if I don't tell them?
You don't. So you don't. So some employers choose not to accept the home test. Because it is hard to give confidentiality, except the rules that you have to follow as well. But it's hard, so how are they going to prove to you, one, it's their test, how are they going to give it to you that it's not someone in their household or a friend that they said, hey, take this test so I can get out of work.
Okay, secondly, pregnant women who have COVID, and then they have the baby who has COVID, or with COVID, that's what happened. Found a situation just last week. Baby was 3 weeks old with COVID. So he got it, contracted it from mom. But you don't start vaccinating until 6 months.
It was just emergency approval. They haven't even approved it yet officially. So they are looking, FDA and CDC is looking at emergency approval of vaccinating 6 months to 4-year-olds.
Okay, so that hasn't even been approved. But this 3 week old baby just crazy. Okay, I was just wondering how that
works.
Yes,
ma'am. Great. When we keep up with the hospitalization rate of patient county citizens who are in the hospital solely because of COVID, no matter where they are in the hospital?
We do not. They did not break down that data for us. UNC Nash shares how many are in the hospital due to COVID, how many are in ICU, but they do not specify what county residents they live in. Neither does Biden.
be able to teach them how to use it. It's not an easy thing to do. That's just that mind of thought.
I mean, the senior room there is to the health department, somebody should look out for you.
We have not received, I've not seen a health test. I'm not familiar with what people are receiving. I've not received it myself. We don't receive them at the health department. All of our tests go to lab or they go to a lab to be processed. We certainly could try, someone has, we have to make sure, first of all, they weren't, you can't come in if they think they're positive. So, you know, that's why we test the driver, you don't test the child. So we have that too, you know, we have to, we can maybe guide them over the phone, but.
I suggest that if someone does not feel comfortable or capable of administering a test at home, they should rely on some other testing, like come to the health department to be tested, or go to one of the other testing sites to be tested.
Yeah, my husband said, you don't trust that. Wow.
If a person doesn't feel comfortable using, I've ordered mine, I haven't got mine yet, so I have no idea what it looks like, but, you know, I think that actually can be a useful tool, but certainly it may not be for everyone. And that's why testing is still available through us, the health department, as well as other places. So I guess I would recommend if someone does not feel comfortable administering that to themselves, they should probably rely on an outside provider to do that.
It's similar to the rapid test. You know, when you administer a rapid test, you're supposed to follow up with a PCR test, which is like a lab confirmed test. So you have to kind of take it from a home test. And if you feel like you are symptomatic, you don't really know how to use that test. And so we would encourage you to go and test somewhere and get a PCR test done.
Well, I would say that this is your first attempt for us as a department. They're asking a lot of them. Carmon is pretty good, okay? They're putting a lot on your requests, okay? That's all. Yeah, you and Carmon and Will, you said I'm going to try. I understand, okay? So you're doing a good job, okay? Any other comments or questions before we give them another sign? Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Public petitions.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. We've had three people to call and ask to come before you tonight. The first is Mr. Darius Slinton, who is here. I'd like to.
What's your name now? Please take your name.
Yes. Good evening, everyone. My name is Darius Slinton, Richmond, Virginia. Mr. Wiggins. Board members, Evans, who was so kind of an initial conversation with a few months ago, where I understand the occasions we had to come. Also, I need to give a special acknowledgement to Ms. Logo, who was extremely patient with me throughout my international travels, so kind of to be scheduled for the weather and other commitments. I say green instead of white. It's truly an honor just to be able to come and be here tonight. I understand on the agenda, let me just 3 minutes. I'll do my best to try to.
You're from Richmond, go ahead.
I am. Thank you so much. But I think it's critically important to try to find all the ground at the same time.
Thank you.
I have basically two objectives and one request. The first objective is to return two checks that were sent to me to the finance department, one from Edgecombe County and one from Rocky Mountain. I want to return these two checks. I have to cash them, so I will apologize. That's the first objective. That's easy to accomplish. Second one is to try to raise your level of awareness and understanding regarding the experience I've been having for the past, I want to say now about 5 months, trying to get some clarity in two departments, I think, of critical importance to the functioning and the operations of city and county government. I have a handout for you, right? This is for the commissioners only. Yeah, let me get the mom to back here.
You don't have it.
Yeah, thanks for the reminder. That's the
right.
Yeah, thanks for the reminder. Apostle 13 14 years ago, I purchased a property that's divided between Edgecombe County and Rocky Mountain. Consistently and faithfully, when I got the bill from each district, I paid it by way of check for 13 years. At the end of 13 years, beginning of 14 years, last year, I sold the property. At that time, I learned that I was paying more than I should have been paying per year for 13 years. I brought that to the attention of your leadership for Edgecombe County, Rocky Mountain, who's, I think, in the tax assessor's office. Was not able to get any clarity, but I was able to get some factual information from two employees, one from each, saying that a mistake was made, but they would never come public and say that. The mistake was made because each year, from my limited understanding, as a former state government official, that an assessment or an evaluation should be done to validate the property, the size, and the tax costs. My limited understanding that was not done consistently, which led to me paying more than enough money every year. The sheet I just passed out, you see that what I paid for city tax beginning 2007 up until 2020, all I paid what I paid in county tax 2007-2014. Therefore, I paid approximately $3.63.08 more than what I should have paid. The only reasonable answer I've gotten thus far, everyone, is that there's a statute that says you have 6 years limitation to find the fault and try to get it rectified through city government. 6 years. Because I was not aware of the statute, and because the person who's in that leadership position took the position to try to find the statute to send it to me, which I'm very grateful for, they said, we cannot reimburse you because it's a 6 year limitation. I said, I consistently, as a customer, paid the bill. Paid. But now that I found the error, I cannot be reimbursed for the overpayment. That's my concern. I provided services on the city, state, federal, and international level. I've done work for many government agencies throughout the country and throughout this world. And I am somewhat concerned about the lack of accountability and professionalism that has been targeted towards me in my last 4 or 5 months, just trying to get some constructive resolve on why that is so. That it's being held against me that I paid more money than what I should have been paying. And whoever was responsible for doing those assessments, I wish I had access to the paperwork to see who's important at the time, because that person should have done an assessment, checked the box, then yes, it was 17.7 acres instead of 20 point whatever acres. That's documented in front of me. I'd like to get some resolve, because at that level I was dealing with, at the city and county level, the person I was dealing with, I did not get any factual information to really validate why that is so, other than the statute. As being a former state administrator, I'm very much aware of statutes. And this statute works to the favor of the government. Just read it. It totally works to the favor of the government. And not the customer, who I've been faithfully and consistently for 13, 14 years.
Mr. Peters, can you help us with this?
Yes, sir. You may remember, you may remember Mr. Swift made a request to the board back in August. I believe it was August, correct me, but he brought this attention, brought this request to the board to be reimbursed for that portion of the taxes he paid for those years. The property is assessed at about 20 acres. He learned, I believe, when he sold the property through the buyer survey, that it was actually a little over 17 acres. The tax office, and Ms. Lewis will correct me if I'm wrong, I'm sure, but the tax office is not assessed property annually. There's a assessment of every 7 or 8 years.
statute allowed us to do. Now, you state you are, so you're going to come there for you. And really, we were looking for a way to pay you because we thought you would do it. Okay? But it's just that based on the statute, we could not pay you because the General Assembly has said that we could, based on the statute that they passed. And that is the reason that you've got what you got in checks from us. And we do set those, we do have a we assess the property, we do evaluations every 8 years, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
But the evaluation wouldn't have caught that, would it?
Yes, sir.
We do evaluation every 8 years.
The revaluation notice has the acres and the value and the bill profit.
Okay.
I don't think she said the revaluation would have caught the error, but it would have been an opportunity for the owner to recognize the error.
For the owner.
That's correct.
And that's where we are in terms of what we were authorized, what this board was authorized to pay. That's the way we understood it based on what we understood the law to be. But if the board could have done otherwise, this board would have paid you. But we felt that we couldn't based on the statutory, like based on the statute. We had a long discussion about that and asked our attorney to look for other, was within the statute that we could give you the full amount of. And he said that he could find it. With that said, I thank you so very much. Sir,
I want to return these checks.
Well, we can return these checks, sir. I mean, you made it and give them right to Mr. Peters.
I'm like, give them, sir.
Oh, sir?
Personal and professional intent. Not allow me to sell this at this time. If we would have done the assessment, documented after 8 years, they would have informed me. I was not informed after 8 years.
Well, I'm sorry that we couldn't, but we've done what we consider to be our statutory responsibility.
I believe that. Good evening, everyone.
Thank you.
So that would have been an opportunity that had it been recognized by the property owner to bring it to our attention. Okay. We do not disagree that there was not an error. It has been corrected, but unfortunately the statute does not allow us to go back.
And what to me about the statute says, you've got an opportunity to catch this within 5 years.
That's
if you don't catch this within 5 years, it is only the landowner. That's what the statute tells us.
Until he sold
the property. Right.
Right. He didn't even know he was over.
Next petition.
Ms. Candace Owens has asked to address the board tonight.
Tarboro.
gave yourselves a raise this past year, and you did, but no one could answer how much or what percentage. Well, I found out that the chairman got a 17% raise. Everybody got $150, except for Mr. Wooten, who declined the stipend. So the chairman got a 17% raise, up to $880 a month. The rest of you got a 21% raise, up to $728.39. The state employees got a 2.5% raise. The first time in probably, I think, 3 years. The sheriff's department has been begging for a raise. The school system needs so much. I just think that a 17% and a 21% raise is extraordinary. And I think there are better places to put that money, such as the sheriff's department, for our safety. I was on the town council. I know you don't get enough money. If you got $80,000, it probably wouldn't be enough money. But I wish you would think about that again and reconsider. When Sharon Edmondson was here, she stated that 2018-2019, she, who was the secretary of the LGC and a deputy treasurer for the state and local government finance division of the NC State Treasurer's Office, said that Edgecombe County had reported material weaknesses. The accounts were not reconciled. Several requirements of NC statute, general statutes, were violated. Several funds reported deficits, extensive budgetary over expenditures. Budget. What is the budget? I've never seen the budget. I've never asked to see the budget. But I do understand that there are budget amendments at just about every meeting. And I want to ask you to look carefully at the budget and the budget amendments. We've got to stay within the budget. We have to live within our own budgets, even our own budgets. My understanding is that there are no performance evaluations given to the county employees. How can you possibly reduce the payroll if there are no performance evaluations? And with our census down 13.5%, or 7,652 people, we're going to have to cut payroll somewhere. We've got to cut some money. We've got to save some. We've got to find some money and stop spending money. There is a county manager, assistant county manager, deputy county manager, and together they make $313,000. And then I tried to decipher all of this auditing, all of the auditing bills, and the best I came up with, which included the $80,000 from last month, was about $204,000, and that included a $10,000 contract for assistance for the preparation of financial statements. Well, you put those two numbers together, and that's over $500,000. So that's a good starting place to cut some of this. The QVC file is going to figure into all of this. I don't know what that's going to do to our tax base. We've got to change something, and we have to change it immediately. And I want you to give that serious thought as to how we can change the direction we're going, because we're going south on a roller coaster. And we've got to stop it. This is not fair to the poor people in our poor county. Our tax base is the second highest in the state. It's higher than Northampton County, Washington County, Berkeley County, Robeson County. We are 95 cents on the $100.
If we have to pay back that $3.7 million, which I hope we don't, I don't know where we'll come from.
And we can't raise the taxes anymore. The poor people, I can't stand it. The poor people, I don't know, they live on what you make here. Some of them.
So thank you for your time. It's a real concern of mine. I'm so sorry that I feel so strongly about this. I just want you to really consider your budget. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Next we have Mr. Camille Fancy, who's asked to address the board.
Can you hear me now?
There you go.
Okay. I'm Camille Sampson, just a P.O. Box 1391, Pinecroft, North Carolina. Physical address is 127 Midway Lane, Tarboro, North Carolina. I like to say that we're 3 miles out of Pinecroft and 7 miles out of Tarboro. First of all, I got a call on the way here, and I think I'm strong enough, right? I'm going to throw it out there, and I stand to correct it. But I have been told to ask why the social services with the COVID issues, why are all the staff working in the office at the same time instead of staggering them? There was a question about it.
I didn't get the comment. What was that?
It was saying that with all the social services and the COVID issues, why are all the staff working at the same time instead of staggering them? I guess from in the office and from at home, I guess. But I think that's what they're trying to say. But I get the clarity to you. Okay, I'm going to start with another now. Good evening. First of all, thank you for allowing me to serve on the Edgecombe County Animal Welfare Council. I don't see anything on this agenda about a report on the Edgecombe County Animal Shelter. I will hope that each month a report will be given because the need of a new animal shelter should be a high priority. I hope you will update the sheriff vehicle with time out. I was at Edgecombe County Christmas Classic basketball game at Tarboro High, and I parked across from an old sheriff SUV. I was typing up a question to my sheriff about it. However, a deputy drove up, and as we were walking in, I questioned him about the year of the SUV. He said that it was in rotation when he was just a deputy. I think he was SRO then. In the early 2000s, if I remember correctly. He said it was not in rotation, that only SROs used them for driving to a school event or etc., and not for patrolling. I also understand that some of the vehicles in rotation have lots of miles on them as well. I don't know the magic number for mileage, but I do know I have passed by a local business for a couple of years, and at any given time, I see several sheriff calls there for repair. It is obvious that Edgecombe County Sheriff's Office is doing a great job because I questioned where was the Tarboro police officers at the game. Someone told me that only the sheriff's office worked the game. However, I also stand to be corrected. I still hope the county can convince QPC to reveal because these folks are taking a huge pay cut from the salary they were making to the little unemployment at North Carolina office. QBC has nothing to do with the amount of unemployment wages, so that was good when they paid them for several weeks at the salary they were making. I know the Edgecombe County Commission, like other entities, have issues and challenges. However, I hope you will attend to my request. Thank you, you in advance.
Thank you, sir. That's all we have to call them.
Anybody email?
No, sir. We received no.
So for the public petition, moving on to other business,
yes, sir. Item A under other business, you see a number. budget amendments. And so I wanted to draw your attention to a few of them. Happy to answer questions about any of them. And just for clarification, as you know, that most of these budget amendments are, the vast majority of these budget amendments is not adding additional money to the budget. It is moving money from one line to another. And it is,
so we have a balanced budget.
We have a balanced budget. It's very typical for county organizations to tend to budget amendments every month. The first one I want to draw your attention to is number one there in your packet. You'll see this is from Board of Elections. So the revenue account, that notes roll from FY21 general fund balance, just to make it clear that those were grant funds that were sent all in advance. This is not a reimbursement grant. So we received that grant last fiscal year. Not all of that grant was expended. And so now we need to roll that balance over, and it's coming from fund balance because we had already received those funds. So I just wanted to point that out.
Is that required to talk about? Yep. The reason for, give us the reason for budget amendment.
Yes, sir. So at the very beginning of the fiscal year, well, actually before the beginning of the fiscal year, but you have to adopt the budget by June 30th of each year for the upcoming fiscal year. You set in place at that time the total budget for the county, not just the total amount, but every what is allotted to every line item. We've got hundreds, I guess maybe thousands of line items over 18 departments and then a number of other budget lines. And so that is the budget that through me we are authorized to administer. And so we cannot deviate from that budget unless you give us permission to. So, for example, this first one here, at the budget you have already adopted for this fiscal year, it did not include $19,000 in one-stop voting expenses in this particular line, or $8,584 in this particular line in the Board of Elections, or the appropriation for fund balance to cover those two expenditure lines. So until you do this, we cannot spend a dime out of these two lines right here. We are not authorized to do that. So, you set a budget at the beginning of the year, and then changes have to be made. Sometimes it's rolling from one line within a department to another. You might have a department head that, we're all estimating at the beginning of the year, they might have estimated $5,000 for supplies, and as the year rolls on, they realize that's not going to be enough. So they might move some from fuel or from salaries or whatever it might be. But they cannot spend that above $5,000 in that particular line until this board votes to make that change to the budget. Number eight in your packet, I just want to draw your attention to, as you see, this is for the Department of Social Services. These are additional funds. We did not have these appropriated to us at the beginning of the fiscal year, $622,713. This is the low-income energy assistance program. Specifically, this is a pandemic appropriation. So this is above what we typically get in appropriation for this program in social services. So you'll see there in that budget amendment, there is the revenue that is increased by $622,000 as well as that particular expenditure line. Item 9A, this is for county administration budget or my budget, and I am asking for an additional fund balance appropriation of $20,000. This is increasing my other professional services or contract services line item in my budget. This is primarily due to some of the additional consulting costs that we have within our department for some of the things that we're working on. There is one additional budget amendment that you have at your table. It's number 19. And also for the public to understand, being that this board only meets once a month, typically, we have that window to get these budget amendments before the board. Sometimes, and if it doesn't get on the agenda, otherwise it will have to wait till next month. And so you all have been gracious and agreeable to allow us that if one comes up between the time that we finish the agenda packet, which is usual on Friday morning, that one comes up after we've already prepared the agenda and sent it out, and it happens, we ask that you consider adding these budget amendments so that we don't have to wait until the next month's meeting. And you'll see this is one that's moving from salaries to telephone and emergency services. And so if you agree to this to be added, this becomes part of the approved budget amendments for tonight's meeting. And also, just so you'll be aware, these become a part of the official minutes that go in our minute book. So if anybody wants to come back and see all of the budget amendments that are approved in a given meeting, Ms. Mungo, track of that, it goes to our official minute book, and a copy of all of these budget amendments is included with those minutes. So those are the ones I want to draw your attention to, but I'm happy to answer any questions that you might have.
Any questions with those before I make a motion? Motion. Second. Second. Question. All in favor, let me know by voting aye.
Aye.
All opposed, hearing none. The first amendment is all approved. Next agenda.
Item D, the IRS has made a change to its reimbursement rate for mileage. It's going up from 56 cents per mile to 58.5 cents per mile. So I recommend that you approve our new mileage reimbursement rate at 58.5 cents.
Motion. Second. Questions? All in favor, let me know by voting aye.
Aye.
All opposed, hearing none. Disapproved. Next.
Sheriff Atkinson has purchased new rifles for his deputies to replace their issued shotguns. Sheriff Atkinson is requesting your approval to allow deputies to purchase their current weapons. North Carolina General Statutes does allow the governing body to dispose of personal property owned by the county through a negotiated sale. I recommend that the board approves the tax resolution which will allow Sheriff Atkinson to offer these weapons for sale to his debtors.
Motion.
So moved.
Question. All in favor?
Can I see you how much?
It's negotiated. The sheriff has decided to negotiate according to what we have here. We don't have how much. Any other questions? All in favor, let me know by voting aye. All opposed, hearing none, it is approved. Appointments, we have ABC Board.
Mr. Chairman, before you do that, I would ask if you'll consider adding to the agenda you'll have at your place a supplemental agenda item. And so, as you know, Edgecombe County Schools, and we didn't get this in until Friday afternoon after after the agenda had already been distributed. So the school plans to repaint the interior of their schools using funds from the North Carolina Lottery Building Capital Fund. To use these funds for this project, this board must jointly request the release of those funds along with Edgecombe County Public School Board. Therefore, before you use the application for the Public School Building Capital Fund, which has already been approved by their board, I recommend that you approve the same. You'll see it's in an amount of
$148,592.
Do we have a motion? Second. Question. The estimated project begin date 7/1/21, and completion date June 30, 2021. That's last year. So
we
just
getting
it
now,
or
that
long day. I had not noticed it. My apologies. I believe that's confident here. I will follow up with them on that. He is the school system's maintenance director. We have a new maintenance director that you're going to meet.
I got it. Motion and second. Any other questions? All in favor, let me know by voting aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Aye.
6-1. Appointments, Mr. Shetland has recommended for reappointment at ABC Board. Is there a motion to reappoint?
Second.
Question. All in favor, let me know by voting aye.
Aye.
All opposed. either non-deals or real point. Our position or release for review and endangered quality. Oh, the post plan, we have a cease, it's got an attached letter that we don't have anybody to recommend it. You guys want? Go ahead.
I want to recommend the Lane Bryant, here's the PO box 473, Tanita, North Carolina, 27819. I spoke with her and she will deserve.
Got a motion?
Yes.
Question? All in favor, let me know by the vote of my eye. All opposed, she was appointed at least for one vacancy, is that correct?
And that is an alternate vacancy that we still have open.
Yes, sir.
Well, no.
Yeah, I'm not.
We had, reading the letter, Mr. Sandra Davis had an alternate. And I thought at large she was trying to make. So we have one more appointment.
Yes, sir.
Okay. It would be helpful if the board members have a divided act recommend, if we could feel that.
Do you have to be in a certain area or just a per?
I don't think so.
It's not at large.
Anywhere.
Okay.
It would be helpful if the board members all, yeah, I think it would be to recommend the appointment.
So who would be this Bryant?
He got your appointment. She get it first. Outlet and release is anything for our attention now.
Yes, sir, I have to answer the question.
Is there a motion to approve? Question? All in favor, let me know by the vote of my eye. All opposed, hearing none, it is approved. Contract for review and then we walk out.
Yes, sir, you have one contract for nutritional services in our health department.
Motion. Second. Question? All in favor, let me know by the vote of my eye. All opposed, hearing none, it is approved. Departmental reports, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir, you have your water and sewer update in your package there if you have any questions. Regarding your monthly financial summary, I've asked Ms. Catherine Walters, our finance director, to come and give you just a brief overview of that monthly report.
Good evening. Just to compare to our actual revenues for the large capital compared to where we were last year this time, we're running about the same in agro-worm taxes. Last year we were at 76.42%. This year you see that we're at 76.30%. Sales tax, we're right on track. We've actually collected about $58,000 more this year at the same time. Sales and service, which includes permits and fees. That includes inmate housing, registered fees, building and zoning permits. That's up about 7% this year at the same time compared to last year. The DMS revenues, they appear low, but that's normal for this time of the year, which up by the end of the year. But it is actually about 3% higher than it was last year this time. The health revenues are running a little higher than they were this time last year. It's about 7.5% more than it was. So overall, we collected 4% more in revenue than we had at this time last year. Expenditure side, I'll point out that the debt service appears very low. We do have some debt payments coming up. Majority of those for the land from economic development Kingsburg will be posted. They're due in February. We'll see those when we report next month. And the remaining large debt payments are in June, which include all of our water districts. So if you compare your overall expenditures to where we were last year at this time, ironically, it's down to spent about 4% less than what we would have at last year at this time. Knowing that our budget went up $1,000 bonus that we have at this time last year.
Any questions?
Any questions?
Anybody have questions? Thank you.
Also, you have there in your agenda packet, Sheriff Atkinson wanted to share with you his current vehicle inventory and assignment. So you'll see the list of vehicles that he has assigned to his department. Also, the mileage on those vehicles, so that you can see that he has brought to your attention those with high mileage, relatively high mileage, those with red being with the highest mileage. And certainly, you know, we are want to be able to address that and try to purchase more vehicles as soon as we're able to, but he wanted to share that report with you tonight.
Got it covered. Moving on.
Yes, sir. So, manager's report, you have your workforce development indicators that you receive each month. Item B, QVC update. You have the full update there in your agenda packet. I guess I wanted to just share with the room tonight that we have not, QVC has not yet made a decision as to whether or not they plan to rebuild. I know a couple months ago that was circulating that they had, and they have not. They've indicated that it may be a few more months before they have enough information to know that. Of course, we are hopeful that they do. But in the meantime, our region's workforce development agency has been working hard with all of their network of partners to try to help as many QVC employees to get reemployed as quickly as possible. They've had both a virtual and an in-person career fair just for QVC employees. They will have more of those scattered through the next upcoming months. You'll see that there is an in-person fair scheduled for tomorrow, in fact. And then there will be another virtual fair on the 18th. So I think those have been beneficial. There was, 130 employees that participated in the first virtual session, over 300 that attended the career event at the Rock Mountain Event Center. That was on January the 20th, so we're very happy for the work Attorney Boone and all of their partners, including the community pilots, have been doing and working together to try to help them to get reemployed as quickly as possible. Item C is coming close to our time of the year that we have your annual retreat. I would propose that we have that on March the 21st. That's about the time of year we had last year and previous year, so I'd recommend March 21st as the date for your retreat.
Any objections from the board? Hearing none. Right.
And we'll follow up as to with the agenda and the location. Now I'd like to give you
also.
Yes, sir.
Well, we'll be back for another meeting before this.
Yes,
before
that's okay. So now I'd like to give you a brief update on where we are with the FY20 and 21 audits and our fiscal improvements. And so the FY20 audit is very close to being completed. We are now addressing some questions and additional information requests that we received from the auditor. And we hope to have that all done and wrapped up in the next few days. Once we do get the final draft of the FY20 audit, I would recommend that we first call the budget committee to meet to give us the opportunity to present that to the budget committee. And then shortly after, I would recommend that that you have a special meeting so that the full board can get a presentation from the auditor of the FY20 audit. At this point, I don't know when I would recommend that to be, but I just wanted to give you that heads up, so that we can hopefully wrap that up before your next meeting in March.
But I would suggest that while you've got the budget together, get a date from them that we can come back and call us, the rest of us, and we can have a date before they get that budget committee, okay?
Sure. Yes, sir.
So you can go ahead and check with us.
Yes, sir. Okay. And so now that we're in short rows, so to speak, with FY20 audit, you know, the last few weeks, just about all of our attention, resources, time, and effort have been poured into doing what we need to do on our side to get that wrapped up. Also, the auditor has started on the FY21 audit. They were on site last week for 2 full days. And so we are still pressing to have that completed by the end of February, as you all have directed us to do. In addition, I'd like to add that we have, in addition to training that many of us have had over the course of years, several of us attended some additional training here recently that was offered by the local government commission on our executive team, the four of us, me, myself, and Ms. Best, Ms. Matthews, and Ms. Peters, attended the training, as well as Catherine and three of her staff members attended that, and a number of you commissioners attended that as well. So thank you for that. We're continuing to work with our consultant, Ms. Jonna Sharp, who is here tonight, having questions for her. Throughout this process of finalizing the FY20 audit and, you know, beginning to work on the FY20 audit, that is enabling her to identify areas to help for her to make recommendations for us for internal improvements for better efficiency so that we can get these done in a timely manner. So happy to answer any questions. Again, she is here tonight if you have any questions.
Any questions? So, Ms. Sanders or Ms. Sharp?
I'd like to ask her if you're being cordial and showing you Edgecombe County.
Yes, ma'am, absolutely.
Any other comments from the board? Here, not for real.
So you have in your packet also tonight an update on our sales tax report. And finally, for my report, I want to introduce to you our new maintenance director. I'd like to invite Mr. Stan Liberman to come to the podium just so everybody can get a good look at you. And so, as you know, we have Mr. Mike Matthews. I don't want Mike to stand up because Mike, in addition, in addition to Mike being our assistant manager, he was for a time both our interim utilities director and our interim maintenance director. That was a tremendous load for him to carry. He has carried very well. I know he was tickled to death. Paul is our new utilities director. We've met Paul before, and even more happy now that we've got Stan here. But I just want to thank Mike publicly for what he's been doing. And also, you know, there's been discussion about us having a deputy and assistant, but I think it's important to know that these two have to be prepared that when these vacancies come up at a department head level, if we're not able to fill it immediately, they're asked to step in, and they do it willingly, at least when we're talking about it, I guess. And they do a good job, because Ms. Bess has also been, she has been our interim HR director. We now have an HR director, so she's still working her to transition into that as her transition now. So I want to thank them both, but we're very glad to have Stan on the team. He has hit the ground running, already doing a great job. So thank you, Stan. Anything you want to say?
Nothing other than I'm glad to be here, and I look forward to working with Mr. Evans and Mr. Matthews, Mr. Bess, and the board and everybody else in the county. Thank you.
I have just a comment, and that is, you know, there has been some public concern about us and to the executive team. And we have over 500 employees here. And my position is that the manager needs help in dealing with these departments. And I think Mr. Matthews is best. An excellent asset for this county, and those positions will continue to have my support as long as I serve. And I don't intend to die here, okay? But they have my position, but they need. And those of us that supported this, we look at our budget, and this is our responsibility. And we saw what we could fund it, and that's what we did. Look at it from without. It's our decision to develop what we think best for this team, this town. deal with it. And I think we've done that for some time.
That's it from our report.
Commissioner's report.
I just received an email today from Mr. Ben Farmer. Ben is the senior regional planner for the Upper Coast Plain Council Government. And what he's just passed along to me is the fact that on the 25th, and I'm just passing this out to fellow commissioners, you want you to put this on the calendar, on your radar, February 25th from 11 o'clock to 12 o'clock, there will be a webinar on how to use ARPA funding for digital inclusion projects. And if you're like me, out of all conversation that people approach me from the public about, I would say, hands down, it's someone speaking with me about the inability to have internet services. And I just invite you, please, hopefully we can get some help from this. We've got some funding. And this is a great need. Other committees that I serve on across the county, Edgecombe and Nash, it's a problem. And we all need to look at this if we can and make sure that we do all that we can as commissioners to speed this process along. 25th, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock. It's digital again. I'll send each commissioner to catch it.
Boy, I think you need to send it to some of our staff, okay, also, so that.
I will. It must be everybody. Sure. Okay.
Enough, Commissioner. Go ahead, let's go.
After our January meeting, as always, I picked up you from telegram. I always read what's said about the commissioner's meeting. When I picked up Deacon Tullivan that day, I went to what I called the TARPA page to see what they said happened at the meeting. Well, not only was I saddened by it, but I was also disappointed by it. The entire article focused on the fact that we were laid over our office. I have no problem with that. I accept the criticism and they're doing their job. What I was so sad and disappointed about was that they did not feel that it was worthy to mention one troop that we recognize, Mr. Daniel Harris, and the organizations that respond to the PVC facility fire. That night, we recognized that group and that individual for what they've done for our county, and I feel like they deserve that. There are over 100 organizations, I think, President Rob been told, and a lot of first responders and a lot of people that came. And Mr. Harris took a bullet in his face to get somebody off the road. Protect us every day. And I just don't understand why a local newspaper would not at least say that we pointed this out and we wanted to present an individual to be recognized for what we did. It's sad and it's disappointing that these people were not recognized by a local newspaper, especially under the circumstances that took place. Not because the Board of Commissioners recognized. That's our job, and we were willing and wanted to do it, but because they deserve it. And I'm very disappointed that our media did not at least mention it as part of our commission meeting. We all need a little bit of good news. That's good news. Now, all of it, we accept it. We manned up to it. We're doing what we need to do to take care of it. But there's no excuse that this individual, this group of people, what they did, or not even mentioned, doesn't need to pay for it. And that's all I got. I just want to get on the
chair.
Thank you.
Oh, yeah. I wanted to ask our attorney. I serve on several nonprofit organizations. Ones I believe in, like Boys and Girls, that's right. So I want to know from you, Senate Bill 473, taking that into consideration, should I be thinking that I should resign from all those nonprofits
and not put it out.
Right? Yes, sir. It'd be good practice for, the statute says if you intention to do it, it would be good practice for board members to let Mr. Evans and me know what entities you are associated with. The statute defines that so that we can be aware of any conflict.
Have we had an update on, I've got some calls, have we had an update on the school board concerning the schools in Rocky Mountain, Edgecombe County side? $100,000 position that everybody was talking about. The public, our relatives in Rocky Mountain, nobody's heard the same. I don't really know where they're on.
So we plan that to be an agenda item for your retreat. I think that would be a better set because it would give us a little bit more time to be here, but there have been a lot of work that's been done, a lot of people that have been talked to, Cannon. We mentioned him several times, and so he will be on the agenda for the retreat.
And he is working. He's moving around.
Yeah, I've heard him moving around.
He's gathering information.
Yeah.
He's gathering.
I just want to make sure all the listeners know our constituents are asking us. I have heard of it.
Yeah.
Attorney's report. Mr. Chair, I'm sorry. One thing I didn't have on the list, I should have mentioned. You'll remember Community Voices initiative that we rolled out several months ago. We had a number of things where we're trying to improve our communication from our citizens and to our citizens. A number of things that we've been doing. One of the things we talk about is planning to do a Citizens Academy. Nyree Peters, who's our intern, has been working on that. That's actually geared up to start on February 22nd. We were limiting it to 10 people because of COVID. We felt like it's best to have it in person, but we didn't feel like we could safely do it with more than 10 people. So we've limited it to 10 people. Right now we have 7. So if there's anybody still interested, we've got 3 seats that are still available. And there will be on a number of topics scattered throughout about 8-week period. And so just want you to know that we will soon be doing a Citizens Academy.
What date was it? The 27th?
The first session will be on February 22nd.
Okay.
Oh, start tomorrow.
That's right. So it was slow sign-ups on it, so we slid it back.
Is it full?
We have 3 seats still available. Okay. If you know someone who's interested.
At this time, ladies and gentlemen, we're scheduled to go into a closed session to discuss economic development. All right, welcome to the closed session. Questions? All in favor, let us know by the voice of the House.